Tell us how Nancy's doing first. just about the military. As a matter of fact, the physical thing, the doctors were just aghast. But the other half of them, they said they'd never seen them recovery from day one, so far ahead of schedule.
That's great.
The day after the operation, I was walking around the corner in the hospital. And so he seemed getting on just fine from that.
That's crazy. Great courage to other women. That's great.
The other was really, it'd be a blow to anyone, but her relationship with her mother was usually something just literally worship.
Well, that's what we wondered about, you know, so soon after. You know.
Yeah, that's I am the one who had to break the news. Listen, maybe we should hope that George will hang up the phone and get here any minute. Probably Gorbachev or someone. Tell you to call him back.
Put him on hold.
Maybe it's coming to
he's got Roman.
This one pool right behind his house. The selectman wrote to him and asked him how he feels about
Gorbachev.
He sent back a very diplomatic letter and he says, anything you decide is all right with me.
A nudist swimming pool?
A nudist swimming pool. They go there every Sunday. Yeah.
Well, that's why he has to borrow my binoculars. Well, we've got a big week ahead of us, and I'd like to begin by having, yeah, I better look around here. Where's Howard Baker?
Right down here.
There. Okay. Oh, I knew you. I was getting mixed up with that other Baker. I thought that maybe Howard could give us a report on the meetings that he and Jim Miller and Frank Carlucci have been having with several of you on the Hill in an effort to reach a budget agreement.
Mr. President, let me repeat what I told you earlier in the day. It's amazing, really, that the intensity of desire to get an agreement seems to go down in inverse ratio to the Dow Jones going up. And the sense of emergency, the sense of absolute necessity to get something done has just slid. You know, it just isn't there as it was when we began this at the beginning of last week. The meetings are still underway, and we'll convene again at 11 o'clock today and continue negotiations. I guess that the negotiations are as remarkable for what they have not done as for what they have. And what I mean by that is while many in the press and a lot of people in general have speculated that there'd be great big proposals for new taxes, the truth of the matter is there has been no serious discussion of significant taxes beyond those revenues that were included in your budget, plus a few odds and ends that Democrats have put on the table, but there have been no big ticket tax items that have been seriously discussed by that group. So the first thing I'd say in that regard is that I'm reassured, and I hope the group here will be reassured, that there has not been any big move so far to try to have massive new tax increases or any.
Good morning. Good afternoon.
Here she is. There's a friend, Mr. President.
Hi. Mr. President. Good to be back.
Good to have you back. Are you back? I'm asking you when you serve the Secretary.
I'm honored, and I do say yes, very enthusiastically. Thank you very much.
Well, I'm
looking forward to it. It's going to be a good year.
Great.
I think this year is as important as the first, you know. I'm not one of these people that's going to sit around and take a vacation. We're going to go do a lot of work. Is
good.
That all right with you?
That's all right
okay.
with me.
Okay.
Yes. Yes.
Thank you very much.
Well, I guess you've already seen
him. And I've already visited.
All right. Well, we'll go out there and face the madding crowd and the press, and I'll make my statement and turn to you or something, and then we'll come back in here. But the fellow that's sitting out there in the front.
He sort of wants to get back in here, and I said, gee, I wish it was mine. meetings just today. He said I'm qualified for the job because I've been pushing him to work for so many years.
And it'll be a better picture if you stand at the president's left while he's speaking.
Okay.
And then you just trade places at the end when he speaks.
His left is here.
Yep. You're ready? You've seen Robert.
I saw Robert and Marlon. He's a good friend.
And the Department of the Interior. She will give the Labor Department decisive and forceful leadership, didn't we? In case you're wondering, that's my way of sliding into a story. It's about a lemon squeezing contest at the state fair. First man got up and he was gone. He picked up the lemon and squeezed and got out 80% of the juice. The crowd, State Association of Statisticians. Since I've come here, though, I've found that some statistics are 59 months of uninterrupted expansion. November 6th, our expansion will enter the history books as the longest peacetime expansion on record. Been among those tracking 80% of new jobs are full-time. In short, these are jobs that are better paying, more challenging, and more rewarding. This has been an expansion for all seasons and all Americans. For example, in the last 5 years, black employment has shot forward twice as fast as white employment. Since 1982, the real income of black families has grown almost 40% faster than white income. And the share of builders and semiconductors, productivity and production have grown strongly in the past year. This is in part because exports are on the rise. In fact, since I was sworn into my second term, Tolkien talks about how to reduce our nation's budget deficit. We'll be building on what we did last year. We cut the deficit by $73 billion, nearly one-third of what it was in 1986. This last week, the New York Times ran a front-page story headlined Perilous Economic Cures. They've noted that new taxation, for example, could, as the article said, there has been a lot said about the twin deficits, budget and trade, that the possible cure may be worse than the disease. On the trade front, there are those who feel now is the time to close the door and put down the shield of openness, fairness, and yes, productiveness. As we move to solve the budget deficit, preparing America for the 21st century.
About the revolving door between government and the private sector, but this is a record breaker. Let me illustrate. Congress first created the... This is indeed a very special privilege, which I cherish, which makes me feel both very proud and humble. Hardworking women and men, to have the honor confirmed to be Secretary of Labor will be to have a special bond with each of these American workers. To be able to assist them is a singular responsibility because it is in our daily work. I'm indeed. Now doubtless, Mr. President, there will be comment about my being a woman. But one of my predecessors, Frances Perkins, the first woman to serve, and that was before blue jeans. So I have no reason to feel disadvantaged at all. Mr. President, thank you again for asking me to join your cabinet as Secretary of Labor. This is a great honor and an extraordinary opportunity for service. I will do my best to fulfill its obligations. Thank you.
Thank you. This is the operation part. Doctors are all just...
Met the mother at the gala before your first operation. In that green room.
Oh, yes.
Lovely lady.
Oh, yes.
Powerful lady.
Yeah. She was, I don't think there was a policeman or a fireman in the city of Chicago that didn't know her.
Is that right?
Edie Davis.
Yeah.
She participated in so many fundraising things for everyone. And the eulogy that I did out there in the service, I told the story of Nancy and I coming into Chicago on an overnight train from New York, winter morning, blizzard. Mm-hmm. Not a red cap in sight. Everybody made me wave back down the ramp, the tail end of the train. Everybody was...
This is Lisa Jameson, Mr. President.
President, I would like to present the Kinskaya.
Well, I'm very pleased.
And Ivan Yaroshchenko.
How do you do?
Thank you very
much. Nice to see you. I'm Mr. Chifter. Come in. This is...
I'm Frank Carlucci.
Frank Carlucci, Honor. National Security.
How are you? Frank Carlucci, how are you?
Hi, Frank. Come in and take the chair over there. Would you please, right here? I have a little
bit. Let's
ever since receiving your letter, you're wondering what I'm carrying here. Our foreign information group were the ones who managed finally to get the letter out, and they sent it to me mounted this way. There is your letter. There is the chart of the hunger strikes. And then over here are the translations of the letter. And ever since I received it, I've had one question above all. How could you possibly write that small?
We have no other choice. So we had to learn how to write. And all my poems were written in 20 pieces of paper. And then secretly passed to my husband, and he passed to America and to Russia some of that.
But it just, I can't think of anything. Yes, and a pen that would be so sharp enough to make that final time, but 10 names on there.
We had to try how to do it.
The necessity. Well, I was greatly honored, of course, when I read the translation of it.
We don't, this letter reached you from our PGB men. They came to us very angry and said, what have you done? Why do you congratulate American president? He's our enemy. We answered, if our government congratulates American president, why shouldn't we do it?
Oh, that's wonderful.
Mr. President, under that roof of stones, I want to bring in a little picture of the two of you, Chad and Swanlow. I don't know that.
Right. Some of the news photographers, these are our own people. The government, but some of the news photographers who might like take some pictures.
I have a small present for you. It is for Sure. a small poem about it. I never thought this poem will reach you, but now it belongs to you. It is